was a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You're the light unto my path. You're the light unto my path.
Okay, this is the topics class if you're here for the first time, and we are studying the last days. We've been in a series of lessons where that phrase, the last days, is found. Now, tonight we're in James chapter 5. Pardon me. The fifth chapter of the book of James. And, anybody need a lesson sheet back there? Need a lesson sheet? Okay, we got quite a few of them here. Okay, James chapter 5 is where we're going to be looking at. Notice at the end of verse 3, it says, the last days. That's the last three words of verse 3, the last days. And then if you look down at verse 7, it says, be patient therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. And if you look down at the end of verse 8, it says, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. So this chapter is about the last days just prior to the coming of the Lord. So let's look to God in prayer, and we will then examine the scriptures together. Heavenly Father, we bow before you now and do pray that you would bless the study of your word. May it be a rich blessing to each and every one of us. And we do ask you, dear Lord, that you would just open the understanding of our heart and give us to grasp and understand these great truths that are found in your word. And Lord, as we see these prophecies unfolding right in our own lifetimes, Lord, we do pray that we just might magnify Jesus and glorify you, Lord, because of your wonderful word and all that you've done for us. Now bless, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, the title of our lesson is The Wealth of the World. And if you'd follow with me as I read, I want to read the first three verses here. James chapter 5. Go to now, ye rich men, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you, and shall eat your flesh as it were fire. Ye have heaped treasures together for the last days. That's the prophecy that we're going to look at. Now notice it says in verse 1, he's talking to rich men. So right away we have to determine who are these rich men. And if we look at the first chapter of the book of James, we find out who they are. Who is James writing this epistle to? Well, it says, James, the servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes. So right there we see that the rich men are rich Jews. It's written to the 12 tribes. And then it goes on and says, which are scattered abroad. So that would not be rich Jews that live in Israel. It would be rich Jews that live in Gentile lands. So three things we know about these rich men. Number one, that they're Jewish. Number two, they live in Gentile lands. And number three, that this takes place in the last days. So we have those three things we can derive from this portion. Now let's read on. He says that in verse 2, your riches are corrupted and your garments are moth-eaten. And then in verse 3, he says, your gold and silver is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you. Well, cankered and rust is something that gold and silver do not do. Now, someone has said that when the plain sense of Scripture makes sense, we look for no other sense. We take as much of the Bible literally as we can. That's the way God intended it. However, when we read here about gold or silver being rusting, Then we have to conclude, because gold and silver doesn't rust, we have to conclude then that it is figurative or symbolic language. So if it's figurative or symbolic language, what would that mean? Your gold and your silver are cankered and rusted. Well, to me, that would say that it was unused. In fact, this passage even conveys that idea, because at the end of verse 3, he says, "You've heaped treasure," and the treasure there being the gold and silver, "you've heaped treasure together for the last day." So it's unused, it's in piles. Symbolically and figuratively, it is rusted. Now, ever since the earliest of times, going all the way back to the Garden of Eden, gold and silver have been used for a means of exchange. We call it money. This is what money is. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 11, now the fall of man didn't take place till Genesis 3, but in Genesis 2, where God is giving the description of the area around the Garden of Eden, he said that there is a river, and it is, he gives the name of the river, and he says this river is where a place where there is gold. That's Genesis 2:11. So God, in his infinite wisdom, even before man fell into sin, he had it planned out that there would be a place where gold would be found, and this gold would be used as money, as a means of exchange between human beings. Now, if we look in the book of Genesis chapter 23 and verse 16, we find one of the early usages of money here, way back to the time of Abraham. And Genesis 23:16 says, "And Abraham hearkened unto Ephron, and Abraham weighed to Ephron the silver." So he had to weigh it. There was no fixed currency in that day. And so he probably carried a little scale with him. When you wanted to buy something, you put gold and silver or whatever it was you're using, and you weigh it out. And so Abraham here weighed to Ephron the silver, and it goes on and tells us there was 400 shekels of silver. And then look at the next two words, current money. That was what money was back in those days. That was current money. It was silver here being weighed out. Now later on, These pieces of gold and silver, they began to make them of a more uniform weight, so you didn't have to weigh them out each time. And in Genesis 20:16, we read that unto Sarah he said, "Behold, I have given thy brother 1,000 pieces of silver." So apparently these pieces of silver were of equal weight. Then Genesis 37:28, we see where they sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. So here again is they were now in pieces, which would be of equal weight, so you didn't have to weigh them. The pieces of silver or the pieces of gold were already weighed out, and so there was a price, so many pieces of silver. Then by the time we get to the book of Ezra and Nehemiah, we find that they had coins of a fixed weight. In Ezra chapter 2, verse 69, it says, "They gave after their ability unto the treasures of the work 80,000 drams of gold and 5,000 pound of silver." And in Nehemiah, we read pretty much the same thing, 20,000 drams of gold and 2,200 pounds of silver. So by this time, they were in a coin that was of a fixed weight. And so this is kind of the progression of money down through human history, starting with the Garden of Eden, or right after the Garden of Eden, with the fall of man, and then right on down there through the centuries. Now, right up into New Testament times, we have a picture here of the early Roman coin, a denarius. That was a silver coin. This was used in biblical times, in the New Testament. Remember in Matthew chapter 20 when the parable was given where they went out into the marketplace and hired people for a penny a day? Remember that? You say, boy, a penny a day. Who'd want to work for a penny a day? Well, this is called a penny in our New Testament. It's not a penny as we think of a penny. It's a silver Roman coin. So it has weight and it has some value to it. Okay, and that's Al right there. He's not a Roman, but he's roaming around right now. Al, you know, Al is, he may not always be on time, but he's always with it. We did the class this morning, and so we already started. Al wasn't here with this stuff yet, and I was getting panicky. I panicked all through the 8 o'clock service. Al wasn't here yet. And so I was just reading there in the book of James where it talks about the coming of the Lord, and as soon as I read that, the coming of the Lord, the door is open. Here comes Al right up to the front. Okay, so we have reading about the coming of the Lord, and we get Al instead, okay? So then the morning class, we sang a Christmas carol to Al. We sang, "No, Al, no, Al." That's bad? Okay. Thank you, Al. Okay, so where do we leave? Oh, yes, the coin, the early Roman coin was the silver coin. Now, in the founding of America, when this country was founded, we had currency or money that coincided with the biblical concept of money. The Constitution of the United States states, Article 1, Section 10, that no state shall make anything but gold or silver coin a tender of payment at of debts. Now, the first United States dollar that was ever coined was not coined in the United States. It was called a pillar dollar. It was the first coin. It was a silver dollar. It was actually made in Mexico because back then we didn't have any facilities for making such a thing. Then we see the first United Colonies dollar that was made in 1776, and notice it was made out of pure silver, stamped on their continental currency. That was for the 13 colonies. Then, as money continued to progress in this country, the next thing we have is the 1794 U.S. government silver dollar, which was also pure silver. See, the Constitution of the United States says that only gold and silver coins are regarded as money and tender in payments, for legal tender of payment of debts. Okay, let's look at the next one. The first American first silver dollar was called a piece of eight. If you ever watch any pirate movies, you hear them talking about pieces of eight. Pieces of eight were eight pieces that comprised a $20 gold piece. And so a piece of eight, there was eight of them, to figure out the value of it, you figure out how much does eight go into 20. And so that was the value, and they called them pieces of eight. That was a very popular currency in the founding of this country. Then we find we had gold coins, and that was our first gold coin here in this country. And I'm not sure whose picture that is on it, but that was our first gold piece in this country. The Constitution says, no state shall make anything but gold and silver coin a tender payment of debt. Then we see the first year of the Morgan silver dollar, that was in 1878, and here again was a silver dollar made out of silver. That was followed by the 1921 peace dollar. We see up there, probably a lot of you maybe got some of those stashed in a drawer someplace. And those of you that are old enough can remember. Betty, do you remember those? Betty, you're lying. You do remember those. That used to be when I was a kid. We had, you know, we had those kind of dollars in currency. All right, and then we have the Franklin half dollar. That also was silver. That was from 1948 to 1963. We had also the Mercury dime that was started to introduce in 1916. That also was made out of silver. All the money that we had in this country was either silver or gold. Then we have the Walking Liberty half dollar, which was again 9.900 fine silver. That lasted until 1947 when it was changed. And then we have also a 150-year-old $1 gold coin. Now, a $1 gold coin is such a tiny little thing you'd lose it in your pocket because gold is so much more valuable than silver. But this is one of our first gold coins dating back 150 years. The date on there is 1850. Okay, go ahead. And then we have a $3 gold piece. That one's a little bit bigger. And that only lasted for about 9 years. That one was never popular. But again, it's always silver, always gold. Then we read after that that we find a $20, there's a $20 gold piece, and a $10 gold Indian coin. That was United States currency. And in addition to that, we have the $5 Indian coin and the $2.50 Indian coin. And then we had more gold coins, the $20 gold Liberty, the $10 gold Liberty. All of these are coins that were in circulation not too long ago, $5 gold Liberty and $2.50 gold Liberty. Now, when I was a baby, I don't remember them, but when I was a baby, this was the currency that was in circulation at that time. It was lawful, legal money. It was gold or it was silver. And here's the $5 gold Liberty and the $2.50 gold Liberty. And then we also had paper money. And our paper money was, as you can see, is quite different from what we have today, but it was different in a lot of different ways. And I don't know if we can read that up there, but right here it states that this is legal tender for all, I can't really read it all, maybe if you got better eyes than I can. We didn't have any problem with that this morning because in the chapel downstairs it was closer, you could see it better. But that was legal tender. You could turn that in for gold or silver. It's a $10 bill, and they would give you $10 in silver, $10 in gold, either one. You could turn that in. Then we have what was called a horse blanket note. And this one, if you notice, right up at the top, it says silver certificate. And it states on there that that is legal tender for, that is, you can turn it in and you could get silver for this. It's a $5 bill and you could turn it in for $5 worth of silver. All right, and then we have something different here. This is called a gold certificate. And look what the promise is right down here. $20 in gold coin. Remember the legal definition of money and the biblical definition of money? The constitutional definition of money is gold or silver coin. You could take this and take it to the bank and they would give you $20 gold piece for that. That was called a gold certificate. Then we also have, here's an early $1 bill, and it states that it is legal tender, and you can turn that in for either gold or silver, or probably silver because it's only a dollar. Then as our money continued to change, here was an 1899 $1 silver certificate. This one could be turned in for a dollar worth of silver. And then progressing right along, here is, some of you probably got some of these in a drawer at home. It looks almost like our dollar bill today, except up right up there at the top it says silver certificate, and down here it says pay to the bearer in demand $1 in silver. So that was a silver certificate. We had another kind of money, and this one, it's a Federal Reserve note, but it says down here we'll pay to the bearer on demand $10. And then we have another kind of money, and this one was known as a banknote. It states, where is it says that? It's a bank. Oh, the United States of America. I can't really read that, but it says it's a banknote. You can turn it in for either gold or silver. So this is what money has been down through the 2+ centuries that America has been a country. Then we have some other kind of money. Which really isn't money. And I hope we never have this next kind of money. But then, getting seriously, here is the picture of a German mark. This is from around 1923. Germany was, after World War I, was in the throes of terrible depression. Notice this is a German mark. It is worth 100, where is it on there? I can't read it. Well, I guess it's right there and you can't read it. It's worth 100,000 marks. See, wow, 100,000 marks? Yeah, but it's worthless. Totally, completely worthless. Inflation got so bad in Germany in those days that they used to pay the workers twice a day. They'd pay them at noon, they'd run out, and their wives would meet them at the gate, they'd give their wives the money, their wives would go out and they'd spend every penny of it. Because if they didn't, the price would have gone up before a couple more hours had passed, and they would have had to pay more. Then they'd get paid again when they got off at 5 o'clock or whatever it was. They'd run out and they'd spend every penny of it. It's the only way you could survive because the prices were just multiplying, skyrocketing constantly. That was because of inflation. They got so that they only would print this on one side. There was no point in printing it on both sides because it was just particularly worthless. And one German beer company decided it cost too much to print labels to put on their beer bottles. They started putting marks on their beer bottles because it was cheaper, because the money was worth less than the price of printing the label would be. So that is runaway inflation. That's what can happen to money, if it's inflated. And what else we got there? Here is Turkish money. We got this over in Turkey last year. Turkey is in trouble with their currency. Notice the denominations on there. Here's 20 million and 10 million. Everything you buy in Turkey is in the millions. The Turkish lira, it's in the millions. And 1 million lira is worth, I think it's around $1.25, something like that, in American money. They've got a big problem. They've inflated the currency to such a point that it's just runaway inflation. And what else we got there? Here's a penny, 1943. Our government tried to get out of the currency, of the constitutional currency in a small way. We made zinc pennies, just made them 1 year because the copper shortage was on and everybody complained about that. So they went the way of all flesh and we don't see any zinc pennies anymore, but zinc is not lawful money. Then, is that the last one on those? Okay. Now, the Constitution of the United States says, no state shall make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debt. Now, here I've got a current $1 bill. It says at the top of it, Federal Reserve Note. It does not say we'll pay to the bearer on demand anything. There's not any promise on this to pay anything. And it does say this note is legal tender for all debts, public and private. That's a lie. It is not. What does the Constitution say? Silver, gold or silver coin is tender of payment of all debts, not a piece of paper. Well, if you turn the page, the next next page is another quote from our Constitution, Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 5. It says that concerning the states, that Congress shall have the power to coin money and regulate the value thereof. So what we have today is not constitutional money, and it is not a biblical concept of money. Now, what do we read here in James chapter 5? It says that in the last days, there's going to be a philosophy that is going to cause gold and silver to be rusted or cankered, which is a figurative, symbolic way of saying unused. It's not going to be used. And then we read also there in that third verse that it will be heaped together for the last days. So we have an interesting concept there. So what does that tell? Pardon me, what does that tell us? Number one, it tells us that gold and silver is going to be demonetized. It's going to be taken right out of the area of money and currency. It's going to be demonetized. Secondly, it's going to be owned by wealthy Jews. That's who these rich men were. And thirdly, it's going to be Jews that do not live in Israel. They're going to be living in Gentile lands. And fourthly, it's going to take place in the last days. So this is our prophecy that we want to examine. Let me tell you a story. Back in the days of Napoleon, living in a place called Frankfurt on the Main, which is today in Germany, there was in the Jewish ghetto there a Jewish secondhand peddler by the name of Meyer Amschel. Meyer Amschel, because he was a Jew, first of all, he had to live in the ghetto because all Jews were told they had to live in the ghetto. They couldn't live where Gentiles lived. But secondly, being a Jew, he could not handle new merchandise. He was a merchant, but he couldn't handle new merchandise. He could only handle secondhand merchandise. That's some of the ways that the Jews were discriminated against. And so he got into the secondhand business, and in the course of his business, he started handling coins. He'd get many coins, old coins, sometimes rare coins, and so forth. And this was kind of both a hobby and a business to him. Well, the reigning monarch at that time was a man by the name of Wilhelm. And he was quite a wealthy man, but he was also a coin collector. And Meyer Amschel would gain audience of Wilhelm because of the fact he would bring him rare coins sometimes, and sometimes even give them to him to gain favor of him. And so they knew each other quite well, although one was sitting on the throne and the other was living in a Jewish ghetto. Now, Meyer Amschel operated his business out of his house. In fact, he had two houses, but he operated his, they were side by side, but he lived in one and he operated his business out of the other one. The emblem of his business was a red shield, and he had a red shield hanging out over there in front of his house, so people would know this is where his place of business. Well, the German pronunciation and spelling of red shield is Rothschild. And it wasn't long before Meyer Amschel became known as Meyer Amschel Rothschild. And so he had access to King Wilhelm, who he did much business with. Well, about this time, Napoleon was on the march. And Napoleon's armies were getting closer and closer. Armies were falling before Napoleon. He was moving, he was advancing. Steadily advancing. Wilhelm was very, very upset because he had much wealth, much treasure. He had gold, he had silver, he had jewels, and he had an art collection. And he says, what am I going to do with this? If I have to flee, what's going to happen to this? I can't carry all this with me. It's too bulky and everything, and it would certainly cause enough of a stir amongst the people that it wouldn't be very secret. And so he was real concerned. In the meantime, Napoleon's army is getting closer and closer and closer. So Meyer Amschel Rothschild came to him one day and he said, I can solve your problem for you. He said, you give your art treasures, you give it to me and I'll keep them for you. Well, Wilhelm didn't want to do it because he didn't trust him. But Napoleon is getting closer and closer all the time. Now, this is just a couple hundred years ago. It's not that long ago. So Meyer Amschel Rothschild said, look, I've got two houses side by side, and underground there's a tunnel between the two that nobody knows about. He said, I'll store all your treasure in that tunnel, that vault down there. And when Napoleon is defeated, you can come back and collect it. Well, Wilhelm really didn't have a choice. So he said, all right, that's what we'll do, but he said, I want a receipt for each item that you take. He says, I want a signed receipt from it. So Rothschild said, no problem. So they delivered it all. They put it in the tunnel, sealed it off. Well, Napoleon's army came. They didn't really look in the Jewish ghetto for much wealth, although they did go through there once. They actually searched his house. They found nothing because they didn't know the tunnel was there. And then when Napoleon moved on, he was defeated at Waterloo. King Wilhelm came back. And the first thing he did was come to Meyer Amschel Rothschild and with his fistful of receipts. And he said, I want to cash this in. I want to my treasure back. And he got every single thing back that Rothschild had stored for him. Everything that was on those receipts, he got it back again. Well, his reputation was enhanced tremendously. People began to realize that this man, here was an honest bank, well, they didn't call him bankers yet, that was coming yet, but here was an honest Jew who kept all of this treasure. He didn't keep a bit of it. He did it all for him. Well, if you had gold and silver money, which is the only kind of money there was, if you had gold and silver money, it's very heavy to carry around with you. If you wanted to go to the store to buy something, you probably would go without any money, and you find out what you want to buy, and then you go back home, get the money, and bring it, because it's just not convenient to carry pocketfuls of gold and silver with you. And so people began to realize this, and they said to Meyer Amschel Rothschild, they said, could we keep our gold and silver in your vault like you did for King Wilhelm? He said, okay. And so he would issue them a receipt. And so many, many people were bringing their treasure, their gold and silver to him, and he issued a receipt for each one. Well, it wasn't long before people began to realize, if I want to buy something, I don't have to go get the gold and silver out of the bank. All I got to do is present one of these signed receipts. They were called banknotes. And he says, all I got to do is present this receipt. And an expression that we still know today was coined. That expression is this: it's as good as gold. Ever heard that? It's as good as gold. The receipts that he issued were as good as gold. People accepted them as legal tender. Debts could be paid in these paper receipts. The invention of paper money had taken place. Well, it wasn't long before the Rothschild family realized that there was nobody on the face of the earth that knew how much gold and silver he had in that vault. Nobody. And they knew that his receipts were as good as gold. And so it didn't take him long to figure out. Now, everybody isn't going to come and want to cash in their receipts at the same time. That's not going to happen. So he began to issue more and more receipts, claiming there was gold and silver in his vault that did not exist. And nobody knew the difference. And so he got richer and richer and richer. Remember the story of Rumpelstiltskin? Rumpelstiltskin tried to spin flax into gold. But that's just a fairy story. And then remember the story of King Midas. King Midas, everything he touched turned to gold. But that also was a fairy story. And during the Middle Ages, we had people that we called alchemists that tried to turn lead into gold. They also met with failure. But Rothschild did something that none of the others had been able to do. He turned paper into gold. And that paper was referred to as good as gold. And that's where that expression originated. Well, what does the scripture tell us? It's talking about rich Jews that have taken gold and silver, heaped it together for the last days. The Rothschild had five sons. He sent them to the five main capitals of Europe and set up a banking system just like he had there in Frankfurt. And this was the beginning of what is known as the International Banking Cartel. This is where it started, just a couple hundred years ago, that's all. And other Jews were taken in to this cartel. They were used as agents and bankers and so forth. And the names are probably, many of these names, very familiar to people, especially if you are 50, 60 years old or so. You've heard many of these names. In addition to Rothschild, there was Schiff, Keen, Loeb, Warburg, Lazard, Dillon, Lehman Brothers, Strauss, Guggenheims, Baruch, Seligman, Ladenburg, Spires, the Baring Brothers, Stearns, Bethmans, all Jewish bankers that sprang out of this banking cartel that were doing the very same thing that the Rothschilds were doing. Well, that's the background of it. Now let's go to another passage of Scripture. If you'll turn, please, to the book of Isaiah, chapter 13. Isaiah chapter 13. And in Isaiah chapter 13, this is a prophecy about Babylon. Not the literal city of Babylon, we'll show you that in just a moment, but end time, prophetic Babylon. Now, if you notice in verse 19, it says, Babylon, the glory and of the kingdoms, the beauty of the Chaldees, excellency shall be as when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. It shall never be inhabited, neither shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation, and so forth. God says this is going to be the fate of Babylon. Well, that is obviously not the fate of the literal city of Babylon or the nation or the kingdom of Babylon. None of those things happened. They were not destroyed by fire and brimstone out of heaven like Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed. They were not to be uninhabited forever and ever and ever, as it says there in verse 20. But when the Bible talks about Babylon, there's literal Babylon and there's end time or prophetic Babylon. Now you can go to the library, you can get a series we've done about Babylon. And in this series we belabor the point that the prophetic end time Babylon is really the United States of America. And I think if you get that series and you check it out, you'll find some things that the Bible says about Babylon that could apply to no other country on the face of the earth except America. Well, having said all that, let's look at verse 17 in this chapter. Here's why we wanted you to turn to it. Verse 17 says, and this is about Babylon, prophetic Babylon, obviously not literal Babylon, because what happened in verse 19 and 20 never happened to literal Babylon. All right, verse 17, behold, I will stir up the Medes against them, which shall not regard silver, and as for gold, they shall not delight in it. Here is a prophecy that says that there will be a nation, a end-time nation, that will have no regard for gold or silver. That is absolutely unthinkable. Gold and silver has been the means of exchange. Gold and silver has been what we call money from the time of the fall of man right up until into the 20th century. But the Bible says there is a nation coming. It's referred to as end-time Babylon. It says that who have no regard for gold or for silver. That is absolutely unthinkable. The money that we have, what we call money today, is really counterfeit money, because it not only violates the biblical concept of money, but it also violates the constitutional concept of money. It is redeemable in nothing, not gold, not silver, nothing. How many of you remember the S&H green stamps? Remember those? Some of you that are probably 50 or more, you can remember those. And then there was the Gold Bell gift stamps, and there was Holden red stamps. There was a bunch of them that used to be around in those days. When you would go to the grocery store or gas station or whatever, you make your purchase, and depending on how much money you spent, they would give you these gift stamps. And they'd give you a little book. You'd take them, stick them in the book. I remember my mom coming home from grocery shopping, and she'd have her little gift stamps, and she'd get her book out right away, and she'd paste those stamps in there. Well, they used to have what they called redemption centers. And you go in a redemption center, and here's the place, the shelves are filled with things. Coffee pots, appliances, toasters, waffle irons, watches, jewelry, you name it. Knickknacks, ceramics, all of that stuff. It was just filled with all these kind of things. And depending on how many books full of stamps you got, you could get something in that category. You say you had 10 books full of stamps, you'd say, okay, anything over here on the shelf, you can have that. But what if you went into the redemption center one day and you got 10 books of stamps and you said, what can I turn these in for? And here's all the prizes sitting back there. And the guy behind the counter says, well, you can't have any of these, but you got 10 books of gift stamps, we'll give you another 10 books of gift stamps in exchange for them. And you say, what a rip, I don't want another 10 books of gift stamps, I want my prizes. Well, he said, sorry, we don't do that anymore. We don't redeem these books in any prizes anymore. That is basically what our government has done with our money. You got some dollars, we'll give you some other dollars in exchange for it, but you don't get gold or you don't get silver. Well, let's look at the story here of the decline of gold and silver out of the monetary realm. The first date we want to look at, and we have a series of dates here, April of 1933. Franklin Delano Roosevelt had just become president about a year earlier, and he signed an executive order saying that all gold was to be removed domestically from the United States currency, which meant that we would still, as a nation, still pay off our debts internationally in gold, but you, as an American citizen, could not get gold anymore. You couldn't have gold. In fact, it became then illegal to even own gold. Now, what happens if you got gold coin? What happens if you got gold certificate paper money? There's only one thing you could do with it, and you had to go to the bank and turn it in for Federal Reserve notes like we use today. And you couldn't spend it, couldn't do anything with it except turn it in, give it back to the government, and they would give you paper dollars in exchange for it. Because it was against the law to accept payment of anything in gold and silver. People used to have gold mines back in those days. And after April of 1933, if you're mining gold, you could only take that gold and you couldn't sell it to anybody, couldn't sell it to a foreign investor, nobody. The only one that would buy it was the federal government. And at first, all they would pay you is $20.16 an ounce, and later on, they upped it to $35 an ounce. And so many gold mines just closed up because they couldn't mine gold that cheap. And they had no market for it. Only the government was their only customer, and they wouldn't pay anything for it. So many of them just closed up. So in April 1933, all gold backing of our currency was removed. Then the second step is in 1944. At Brenton Woods, New Hampshire, World War II was winding down. Europe was in economic chaos. Their currencies were debunked, devalued, and so forth. And what was going to happen as soon as the war was over? This was a major concern. So we got together in 1944 at Brenton Woods, New Hampshire, and an agreement called the Brenton Woods Agreement was designed, which created something that you're familiar with today, the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. That was both came into existence in 1944, never existed before that. Now, the designer of the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank was a man named Harry Dexter White. He was later identified as a communist spy that was working in our government. He had four friends, a man named Lachlan Curry, another named William Allman, another by the name of Nathan Silvermaster, and another by the name of Frank Coe. These were all of his fellow architects of the International Monetary Fund, and they were all of them also were identified as communist spies working in our government. So they were uncovered and they were prosecuted, but the International Monetary Fund, the Brenton Woods Agreement, continued on. Now, what did they decide? This is amazing. It was decided there that the currencies of the world, all the member nations of the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank, that all of their currencies, because their currencies were, you know, the war had made everything so unstable, all of their currencies would be backed by the United States dollar. So the United States was guaranteeing the value of the Japanese yen, the German mark, the French franc, the British pound sterling, all the currencies virtually of the world, every member nation of the International Monetary Fund. The Bretton Woods Agreement says we will make sure that, don't be afraid to take the German mark, don't be afraid to take the lira, Italian lira, don't be afraid of any of these. We'll guarantee the value of it, we'll pay it off in dollars for you. the Bretton Woods Agreement. So 11 years after the gold was removed from our currency, we said we will back the currencies of the world. Then the third step took place. Back up there for just a moment. Another expression was coined that we've heard. The currencies of the world were backed by a United States dollar. Here's the second expression that came around. It's as sound as a dollar. You ever hear that? It's as sound as a dollar. Talking about the world's currencies. They were now as sound as a dollar because back then the dollar was sound. It's not very sound right now, but not like it was. But anyways, then the third step was 1964. Remember the silver certificates that we saw up there? The silver certificates were removed and were replaced with Federal Reserve notes. No longer could you take your silver certificates to the bank and turn it in for silver money. That ended in 1964. Then in 1965, our coins, our silver coins, were withdrawn from circulation and replaced with coins that we have today, which at that time were used to be jokingly referred to as LBJ peanut butter sandwich slugs, because you could take it and look at the edge of it and you find out it's copper. It's not silver, it's copper. It's got a little silver coating on it, but it's a copper coin. Silver was removed, silver coin was removed in those days from our currency. So, then the next step came on August 15, 1971. The gold backing of our money was removed as far as our international debts were concerned. Up till that time, we had paid off foreign investors and so forth. We would pay them off with our gold, but now we even stopped that. So all gold, all silver was removed from backing the United States dollar. Remember what the Constitution said? Only gold or silver coin is legal tender for payment of debts. And now Americans had neither one, not gold and not silver. The final step took place December of 1974. Gold was now completely demonetized, and so a law was passed that went into effect in December of 74. It became legal again to own gold. And once again, Americans could legally own gold because it had successfully been taken out of the monetary system. There was no more gold standard, there was no more silver standard, there was no more two-tier standard, there was no standard at all. All we have is money that has no backing behind it at all. So that is the story of the demonetizing of gold and silver here in America, and not just in America, but really basically the whole world, because all of their currency is based not on gold and silver, but it's based on our currency. Well, if the dollar collapses, what's going to happen to the currency of the rest of the world? That's going to collapse also. Well, if you notice in your note sheets there, 2 Peter 3:8 says, "But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as a day." Now that corresponds with what we read in the Old Testament, Psalm 90, verse 4. 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday, when it is past and as a watch in the night. In both of them, they liken a 1,000-year period to one day. So a prophetic day would be a period of 1,000 years. That's a prophetic day. So we're in Revelation chapter 18, we read about when the finances of end time Babylon are destroyed, what economic chaos it's going to cause in the world. And we read there that in Revelation 18:11, "The merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her," that's Babylon. And by the way, when the book of Revelation was written, literal Babylon had already passed from the scene. This is prophetic end-time Babylon. "The merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth their merchandise anymore." The world is going to be plunged into economic chaos. Now you say, how long is that going to take? Well, In Revelation chapter 18, we have three pronouncements there of how long it's going to take. Each one of these is talking about and connected with money, the destruction of money. In Revelation 18:10, it's talking about the merchants of the earth there, standing afar off for fear of her torment, saying, "Alas, alas, that great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment come." 1 hour. And then we read it a second time in verse 17. In 1 hour, so great riches is come to naught. Then we read it a third time in verse 19. It says that, for in 1 hour is she made desolate. So the question is, how long is an hour? Three times we're told the wealth of Babylon will be destroyed in 1 hour. Well, if one day with the Lord is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day, 1,000 years is one prophetic hour, an hour would be a 24th part of a day, 24 hours in a day. So you can do the math on it, and you'll find that it comes out that a prophetic hour comes out to 41 years and 8 months. You divide 24 into 1,000, and there would be one prophetic hour, 41 years and 8 months. How long did it take the United States to remove gold and silver from its currency? From April of 1933 to December of 1974, you can figure it out, it's 41 years and 8 months. Exactly the length of time the scripture predicts. Well, this is something that is not just going to affect America, it's going to affect the whole world, because their currency is based on our currency. And what happens there is, or what happens here rather, is going to be what happens there. Okay, going to the last page. What about gold and silver in the last days? Remember what it said in the book of James? They have heaped treasure together for the last days. It's been taken out of the monetary realm. What is gold and silver today? It's not money. So what is it? Well, we read in Revelation chapter 18 that it is nothing more than a commodity or merchandise. Gold and silver becomes rusted or unused in the last days, according to James 1. So it's heaped together for the last days. It becomes not cash, but a commodity. Revelation 18:12. It's talking about those same merchandise. Remember verse 11 that said that they will weep and mourn, for no man buyeth their merchandise anymore? Well, verse 12 tells us what their merchandise is. Look at the first thing it says, the merchandise of gold and silver. Gold and silver are not money today. They are merchandise. You can buy it with money, but it's not money. It's a commodity that you can purchase, something you can go to the store and you can buy. And it took 41 years and 8 months to take it out of the realm of money. So where does this leave the world's currency? Well, since 1944, all money was backed by the U.S. dollar, which was backed by gold and silver. But today, there's nothing behind the U.S. currency, not gold and not silver. So what keeps our money, the purchasing power of our money? Why do people accept these pieces of paper? And then the answer is, it's by faith. The Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. It's faith in our government, because we know our government is reasonably stable. That money is going to be worth something, but anything, number of things could happen to trigger it that would, like for instance, war or inflation, like you had in Germany in 1923, Hungary 1946, or Turkey today, where they keep printing more money and more money, inflating the currency, and pretty soon it is absolutely worthless, like it was over there in Germany. And so this would affect the whole world. If our money collapsed, it would bring down all the currencies of the world, or in particular all those member nations of international monetary fund. I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles for just a moment. One more scripture I'd like you to look up, and that's in the book of Zechariah chapter 5. Zechariah chapter 5. And Zechariah chapter 5 is another prophecy about Babylon in the last days. And if you look at verse 6, Zechariah, he sees this vision and he says, "What is it?" And he, that's the angel said unto them, "This is an ephah that goeth forth." And he said, "Moreover, this is their resemblance through all the earth." That word resemblance is the Hebrew word eye. This is the eye that goes through all the earth. You ever look on our money? And what do you see? You all see eye. And then it goes on, and we're going to skip through some of this because time is going. Verse 10, he said, "Then said I to the angel that talked with me, where do these bear the ephah?" And the ephah is the symbol of trade, commerce, money, so forth. And the answer is in verse 11. "He said unto me to build a house in the land of Shinar." Shinar is Babylon. "To build a house in the land of Shinar." Now watch the rest of this. "And it shall be established and set there upon her own base." The eye that goes through all the world, the Yankee dollar, is to be established upon a base in end time Babylon. And that is the situation that right up until this present hour, our money is the base for all the currencies of the free world. And if it collapses, so will all of them collapse. Well, you know what? The United States is completely out of step with the rest of the world. Our thermometers aren't even right in the eyes of the rest of the world. We look at things in Fahrenheit instead of Celsius. They don't like that. And when we measure things, we measure feet, inches, yards, miles, quarts, pints, gallons, and so forth, rather than in metric units. They don't like that either. And then our currency is in dollars rather than in euros, because the euro is now becoming a dominant major currency. That's the currency of the revived Roman Empire, known as the European Union. And then we just found out here recently that we vote wrong in the United Nations. They don't like the way we vote. They don't like the way we do things. And so one of these days, somebody's going to decide America's going to have to go. It's going to start with the currency, But don't worry, Satan has a system to replace the American dollar as the currency of the world. He's got it. It's all in place right now. Nothing more has to be done. All that's involved there is computers and satellites that function on a worldwide scale. And the technology is there right now. When we went over to the Middle East, we found out that in every country, no matter how poor it was, we could use credit cards. And they got the little machine there, just like they do here. They run your card through it, and that tells them if the card is good or not. It tells them if the card is overdrawn. It tells them if the bill is not paid. They get the authorization. How do they do that? How do they get that so fast? Over there in Egypt or in Jordan or Turkey or any of those places, Israel, how do they get that so fast? Well, the same way they do here. It's a computer system hooked up to a satellite, and that information is given out immediately. There's a very, very little waiting period. The only thing that has to happen is that you just trade in the plastic for a laser implant, and this final system of the Antichrist monetary system is in place. Because Revelation 13:17 says, "And no man might buy or sell." Why not? "Save he that has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name." The final world monetary system is going to be not gold, not silver, not credit cards, not paper money. It's going to be a laser implant in your hand or forehead, and that is already not only in the works, it is already working. In 1998, we found out that Israel has some of these already. And they're using them for their espionage system. So they always know where their spies are. And it's linked up to satellites, sends out this emission. These are just tiny little things that are implanted somewhere in the human body. And it emits a signal detectable by satellite to locate the person. And it is a batteryless. You don't have to worry about the battery running down. It runs on the neurophysiological energy generated within the human body. Can you imagine that? Just the energy from your body sends a signal up to the satellite, which is relayed back to Earth, and they know where every single one of these people are. Now, they admit, or this was in November of 1998, they admitted to having 43 people at that time with one of these implants in them, and that could become a much more used thing. So the system is in place right now. When the dollar goes, Satan's got a system all ready and waiting to replace the dollar, to replace gold, replace silver, replace any other kind of currency. And that's his own system described there in Revelation 13. But don't worry about it, because all of that takes place during the tribulation period. And when the tribulation period, or I should say before the tribulation period begins, the church is going to be raptured out of here. So you don't have to worry about losing your fortune. But the Bible says that you can send it on ahead. You can't take it with you, but you can send it on ahead. While there's still some value to your money, you can use it in the Lord's work. And we need a building fund here. That'd be good. Somebody want to start a building fund? Well, you can do it. Okay, while there's still some value in it, give it to the Lord. Well, we're going to stop there. And next week, we're going to look at some of the scientific advances that are prophesied in the last days. We're going to be looking at some of the skills, some of the sciences of the last day. We see prophetic pictures of them in the Word of God, and then see how it's being how it's playing out in this day and time in which we're living. Let's look to God in prayer, and we'll be dismissed. Before we pray, if you need any of the back lessons, we got them up here, except number one. We used up all the number ones. We'll get some more for you. But number two, right on up till today, are right up there. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, dismiss us with your blessing. May the Lord Jesus Christ be first and paramount in our thoughts. And we pray, dear Lord, that we might be always ready to give an answer to those that ask us of the hope that is within us. So bless, Lord, we do pray. And Lord, we do pray that the money that you have entrusted us with, may we be good stewards to the glory of God. Now dismiss us with your blessing, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for coming.